Ja, jawohl. Request immediate relocation. Something is drinking all my whiskey. Ja, everything here has gone kaput. I have no whiskey. I can't command the keep. I can't control my troops. We have Einsatz commandos here who are raking ruin on everybody. They're nasty, they're evil. As you can see, folks, someone is definitely drinking all my whiskey. Little secret. It's me! Cheers, you all. Cheers, folks. How are you all? Hope you're all doing very, very well. It's Herr Kilt-Man here. Hairy Kilt-Man. Let's get this stupidity off my head. Folks, The Keep. F. Paul Wilson's fantastic novel. The start of a huge saga of novels. His adversary cycle saga, which brought in Repairman Jack from the Tomb. Awesome. Another spectacular book. Well, New York Times bestseller for The Keep, and they made a movie out of it. Yes, they did. And you know it, and I've covered it before. I've done not one, but two in-depth videos on Michael Mann's adaptation of The Keep from 1983. A troubled production, a ruined movie, but once you've seen it, you can't forget it. It gets in you. It seeps into you, and suddenly, you know, oh, you watch it again, and you go, oh, I'm disappointed. I remember great things about this, and they go, oh, it frustrated me, it didn't work. And then you go, a couple of years go by, oh, The Keep, somebody mentions it, or it's on some film forum, and you go, oh, I'll watch it again. And you do, and you go, oh, this is great, and then, oh, it hasn't worked again. And that is the beautiful, frustrating mystique of The Keep. As I say, I've covered it twice in depth because it's a film which is horribly flawed because we know what happened. Michael Mann, Last Americans, Heat, for God's sake. You know, this is one of the great demigods of cinema. And only one of his first few movies, after doing Thief as well with James Caan, a great movie, he gets this, a grand gothic Romanian wartime horror movie with tons of folklore and mythology and the origins of the vampire mythology. And it's a brilliant book, and it's ripe for like a filmic, you know, adaptation. And his version looks tremendous, albeit full of 80s smoke and lasers. And yeah, it's pure 80s pop video. But it was ahead of its time. And even though it's horribly cut down from his original version, which ran for, well, most films, when anyone makes a movie, they do a lot more scenes than you're ever going to see. But his version, he planned it to be a 3-hour movie, or maybe a bit longer than that, 3.5 hours, which is a bit ambitious for a guy who really was just cutting his teeth in cinema. And the version that came out was not his film at all. As I say, the effects guy died whilst filming, so they had to cobble together effects. They lost so much footage. It test screened really, really badly. And then he was like, that's it. I'm out of here. I don't give a shit. It's 6 of 1, half a dozen of the other. Did he jump or was he pushed? Well, it's both. And in the end, the studios cobbled together with a guy that didn't know how to edit any movie at all, put together a rush-released version which ran for like 95, 96 minutes. Not even half the length of the film that he was meant to put out there, reputedly. And the version doesn't work. It doesn't work. But it has enough spectral quality to it, which, and spellbinding atmosphere that you keep returning to it. Once you know the Keep, the movie, not the book. Here is the book. Here is F. Paul Wilson's fantastic novel of The Keep, the start of the adversary cycle. The film is a separate entity and it takes on its own life. We know its backstory, we know its troubled history, and we know why it can't possibly be a fully finished movie. But you watch it and you go, oh, I love the intro, I love the first half of it, I love so much about this Tangerine Dream score. You're hearing Tangerine Dream right now, and some of the score for The Keep will be in this. The people that have seen my two previous videos about The Keep will have heard the full score. I have the full score, but at the moment I still can't play the full score because it's locked on a dead PC with a dead playlist of music and a few fucking thousands of scores are on that, and I can't play them. They're on my phone, but I'm recording on my phone right now, so I can't play them. But and it does not do my head in because I really love the score for The Keep. And Tangerine Dream, again, like the movie, it's so convoluted in copyrights and licensing laws, and people don't want to know. Michael Mann took his name off it. I don't want nothing to do with it. I had a nightmarish time there. I don't want to be involved in this movie. And Tangerine Dream, who have split apart and come back and split apart and come back, and like, ah, okay. And they know the whole rigmarole of this and the mystique of The Keep at its score. So, yeah. Before you go like, yeah, well, I've got the full score for it, Kilt-Man. They released it. Yeah, but the full score, the official score, only has 1, 2, 3, 4 four tracks actually from the movie score itself in the film. The rest of it's just other Tangerine Dream stuff. But I've got the full score, and it's a wondrous treat. So the film is hugely problematic. So, Kilt-Man, you've covered it twice before. What are you going to talk about now? Well, two things. There is a remake which has been mooted about since 2019, 2020 maybe. Greg Nicotero, special effects wunderkind, or wunderkind as the Germans would say, was going to do this. He scored rights with F. Paul Wilson, the writer of the original novel. And it took him a long time to do this. After Michael Mann, in his version, sort of became cataclysmically a saga of what not to do in movies. But they knew there's a great novel there, and there's a great way of putting this on screen and telling that full story. So after years and years of legal wrangling, Greg Nicotero got the rights to it. He is from The Walking Dead with Robert Kirkman, and he was part of the KMB makeup effects group who worked on Day of the Dead, Evil Dead 2, From Beyond, and many other movies. This is a guy that went from makeup effects to directing and is brilliant. So he's like, I'm going to do this. This will be wonderful. So gets the rights to it. And what happens? A writer's strike. which we all know about. It clawed, COVID and a writer's strike clawed into Hollywood and movie production for a good, 18 months, or almost 2 years, and the backlog that then ensued. Now, that was back then. The last update I had on this, a remake of The Keep, was 2023, and he said, yeah, the writer's strike did destroy things, but We're still developing it. Well, great. There you go. We're developing it. There's no more news on that. So, Kilty, what the fuck are you talking about then? What new stuff have you got on the keep? Well, hold your taters. The Keep. Michael Mann's version of The Keep. Which, you know, we know it and we love it. We are frustrated by it. I watch it. I go back to it a lot with high hopes that I'm going to see something I didn't see before. And I always come away going like, oh, God. There's so much I love and so much that I just... Why? And what happened? And shouldn't you have done this? And what? Oh, there's bits missing there and there and there. But the beauty of The Keep, Michael Mann's version, is that it doesn't leave you. Once you've watched it, and you go, and you may go like, oh, I hate it. I think it's a piece of 80s pop jazz gothic shite. Well, you may think that, but it stays in your mind. The imagery, the visuals, like 80s pop videos, they linger. And I was abroad during all these times. I was ootin' about and giving it loads. So 80s pop videos ruled my life. And 80s horror movies ruled my life as well. And I adored The Keep. But I also knew it was a hugely flawed film. But I also knew its background and knew that it was troubled. But you watch it again and again. And the thing is, you try to find a bit more, but it still leaves you, you're still frustrated and disappointed. It could have been something. There was so much more there. Scott Glenn, looking like the Stan Winston head effect for Arnold Schwarzenegger in the Terminator, when he's like, he's doing his eye, and it's the skinhead, but with the big neck tendons. Scott Glenn, he's like that, but he's fucking ripped and lean as Glaken Trishnadatis, who's going to take on Rassilon Mossilar, who's the big demon who's secreted in the keep in the Carpathian Mountains in Romania, the old Wallachia, the land of Dracula, of course. And this guy, this demon, poses once Germans arrive there to use the Dinu Pass, because the Russians could come across the steppes, you know, to invade that way, unbeknownst to the Wehrmacht. But so they send a little Jürgen Prochnow from Das Boot, leads a German army into the keep, and they secure that area, but they start getting wiped out because, well, Rassilon Mossilar takes over because greedy Germans think that all these crosses embedded in the walls of the keep, which in the book there's like, I think there's 11,208 crosses, but in the film there's, hang on a minute, I wrote this down somewhere, there is, I didn't write it down. There's 208 or something like that. It's a lot smaller number of crosses which are embedded in all the walls. But the Germans think that they're like, they're silver, but they're not, they're nickel. But two Germans, Otto and Lutz, discover that, hang on, there's one down here. That's shining bright. And Lutz cuts through, because it's silver, right? And like, but in so doing, they unleash the demon that's been hidden within the keep. And that demon will then start destroying the German soldiers, to the point where Captain Wehrmann, Jürgen Prochnow, will request, you know, reinforcements, because, you know, oh Jesus, we're getting, something's murdering my men. And they send in SS Einsatz commandos led by Gabriel Byrne, Sturmbannführer Kampfer, who's a right bastard. He's a pure Nazi fucking evil shitbag. Who, the minute he arrives in this little village there, they just drag three people out of the village and just machine gun them. Right, and then we'll take five more hostages. You know, because you partisans, anyone else, another German soldier dies, we'll kill three more of you. Oh, fucking hell, you know. But Wehrmann is Wehrmacht, he's German army. And he's a compassionate soul. But they find all like hieroglyphics on the walls, which are old Romanian. Well, who can read old Romanian? Well, there's only one guy. It's Gandalf. It is Sir Ian McKellen. The young Ian McKellen. Playing the Jew, Theodore Kuza, and his daughter. he was brought up in a village there, and all the people go like, look, there's only one person that can read that, and they've got guns in it. There's only one person who can read this. He lived here, but he went to Budapest or whatever. Well, go find him. Well, you've got him, they say to Gabriel Burns, fucking SS, fucking bastard. Why have we got him? Because he's a Jew. He's in one of your extermination camps. Oh, well, it'll be easy to find him then. So they bring him, Ian McKellen. And McKellen's great in it because he's a much younger man back in those days. See, 1983, a Shakespearean actor. He's been in many, many movies, and had been in a lot of stuff by that stage anyway. But they put old age makeup on him. So he's a really old, decrepit looking guy in a wheelchair, but he knows the stuff. And the point is, he's a Jew, so is his daughter, and the beast that they unleash, or has been unleashed by the Nazis, is, well, it just wants out. It wants to destroy the world. It wants to do whatever it fucking wants to do. But it will use people to manipulate them. So Theodore Kuza gets coerced because his daughter gets, well, almost raped by Germans, by the Nazis, but Molosor is Rassilon back to front, and he comes out and destroys the Germans, and then saves the daughter, brings her back to Theodore Kuza, and it's a wheelchair, but he, who are these people? I put his hand on Theodore Kuza's head, and like, his youth returns, he becomes younger, healthier. But Rassilon, Mosselor, can't go outside the keep because there's something stopping him. Something, because he's not a good guy, but he'll make himself out to be a good guy. Allah, the golem, the defender of the Jews, the big clay effigy of a warrior to defend the Jews. He basically plays that role, but he's taking the piss. He's just using this guy, Sir Ian McKellen, to like, you've got to remove, there's a talisman here deep underground, but you've got to remove that, and like, once that's gone, I can go out and I can do whatever I want. But I'll kill all these people who are killing our people. That's what he says. And the Germans, the Waffen-SS, they're in the black garb uniforms, which they weren't wearing at that particular time in history, but it doesn't really matter. The whole point is they're SS, they're Einsatzkommandos, they're pure Nazi bastards. And this guy, Rassilon, Molosor, is gonna like, well, I'll work with you and I'll save our people. But he's not, he doesn't give a shit about anybody. He just wants to take over the world. The film is great, and here we've got a bit of the actual genuine soundtrack to The Keep. This is tremendous. So, I've talked about the film. I'll put links to my two videos I've done previously, and which I go in depth on it and all that. But the reason why I'm doing this, the sequel has been mooted again, but there's still no actual evidence that anything's taking place on the sequel, the remake, which we could definitely do with. I sit here so many times and say, like, oh, another remake, a prequel, a sidequel, a fucking spin-off, and I hate them. You know, we all do, you know. But another adaptation of F. Paul Wilson's The Keep, yeah, we could do with it, because that film is great in its own flawed, fractured, broken, troubled way. It's wonderful. But a proper, fully focused version adaptation would be amazing. It would be amazing. But there's something else. There is other news. And it could be fake news. It could be fake news. Vinegar Syndrome is a video label, a home video label, and rightly or wrongly, they released on their page the video artwork for The Keep. Now, for a long, long time, people have been lobbying to get just The Keep, Michael Mann's version, even its 96 minute version, just released on Blu-ray and or UHD as it is, because every version that's out there, and I've got about three or four different versions, they're shite. They're utter shite. They're pan and scan. They could be widescreen, but they're really letterboxed and horrible, and the quality is disturbingly nasty. But they know, they've been asked repeated times, can you get this movie out? And they did sort of put it about that, oh, we're putting out something which has got a bizarre cast. You know, Scott Glenn, Ian McKellen, Gabriel Byrne, Jürgen Prochnow, you know, and Robert Prosky. Robert Prosky is in this. Who is Robert Prosky? You're asking me. He's in many movies. Right before he did The Keep, and he plays a Romanian priest with shaggy black hair and a big black beard, and he's great in it. Although you can tell that a huge chunk of his footage is not there, meaning there's a huge plot hole. You're like, what the hell? Why did he go from being a really good guy to a really insane, fucking bizarre guy? Right before this, he did Christine, John Carpenter's Christine, an adaptation of Stephen King's novel Christine. And he plays Darnell, Will Darnell, who owns the garage. And he's big, flabby faced, and he's like, and he's got like Arnie Cunningham, and he's like, you know, Arnie Cunningham, like, you know, you can put the little toilet roll on the spools and clean up around the place. And like, you know, and like, you can do whatever you want to your car, which is Christine. Excuse me. But he then plays this guy, and it's hard to see because he's with a big beard on him, and he's got shaggy long black hair. And a scene that's removed from the movie is he has a dog with him all the time. And then when he goes completely renegade, and which is meant to mean that Molassar Rassilon's influence is spreading out from The Keep, that all the villagers are all going insane as well. It's not depicted very well at all. A lot of those scenes are removed, but he he sacrifices his own dog and bathes in its blood as well. And like, but you only see it for a snap second, and you're like, what the hell have you just seen? You've got no idea what you've just witnessed. But he's great in it, and you just want to see more of him. You want to see more of everybody. As I say, like, Scott Glenn's got these super sort of, you know, Stan Winston neck animatronics and prosthetics, because he just looks, he is a T-800, he is Arnie, his jaw, his face, his eyes go fucking bizarre, and he's got the same haircut as well. He is a Terminator. Anyway, Vinegar Syndrome, put out on their site, maybe erroneously, with an artist, the depictions of a VHS cover. This is commissioned this year in 2024. They commissioned an artist whose name is Edward Kinsella the Third. Edward Kinsella the Third did artwork and put it out on Instagram or their site anyway. I have the pictures. I have the VHS cover that which he's done, and the Blu-ray UHD cover which he did. Now, I can't show you them, and I can't put them on the thumbnail either, because the minute he put them up there, someone spotted it, and oh my god, the keeps coming out from Vinegar Syndrome, and he took it down. And like, oh my god, and he blocked the people that had seen it from, he blocked them from his page, his profile. So, does this mean we're finally going to get a Blu-ray UHD remastered cut of Michael Mann's The Keep? I genuinely hope so. Back on the artwork. The artwork is, it's this, which is a take. Look, see here. There's the original book. That's the original book cover, right? That is not how Molitor Rosalam, it's back to front, looks in the movie. But it's pure vampire, as you can see by the fangs there. Now, but the original VHS and Betamax home video cover for The Keep was a crucifix and this sort of and sort of like a cartoon version of the monster that you finally see. Mosalar Rassalam transforms throughout the movie from a smoking, towering, hulking brute with a glowing brain and light bulb eyes into like a big muscle-bound, hulking, crazy fucking badass. And you got that sort of combination on the poster with a crucifix and Germanic symbolism all over it. Well, the image that he's done, this is the guy again, Edward Kinsella the Third. You can Google him. I'm not showing his pictures, but you can find it. I'm sure they're archived somewhere. I've got them, I've seen them. And they're great. Edward Kinsella, they're pretty damn fine. And one of them is a take on that image there with the, let's turn it back that way so you can see it, with the face leering through a crucifix. Blazing red eyes and a sort of bluey, horrible, bizarre, cadaverish face. And the other one is pure Mike Mignola. Now this is the cover which, now Vinegar Syndrome on their site, because I've seen the pages which have been taken down, they said yeah you can buy these prints. This print's for our VHS slip cover and the other print's for our Blu-ray and UHD cover. And the other cover is pure Mike Mignola. Mike Mignola, Hellboy. I've talked about Hellboy, I've shown you imagery from that before. The Hellboy comic books have a very distinctive, it's red, it's black, it's beautifully gothic and really highly stylized. And the other image for the UHD Blu-ray is exactly that. I thought, what is Mike Mignola, and he has various artists, but Mike Mignola, who writes Hellboy, also does illustration as well. So I thought, like, my God, I think that's, is he involved in this? Because that would be amazing if he was. But no, apparently not. So they've took it down. They've took the imagery down. You can go online right now and probably, you'll probably find it. But I know for a fact that the other day when I discovered all this, they were took down straight away. And so, are they doing the most requested title to any specialist boutique label? Are they releasing it? A couple of years ago, no, a bit more than that in fact, there was a big Kickstarter campaign to do a documentary about the making of The Keep, interviewing every surviving member of the cast and the crew, and who would actually want to be involved. Obviously Michael Mann wouldn't want to be there, but and really in depth, they really went to town on like what they were going to do, how in depth they were going to go. And well, where's that? That hasn't happened. So there is talk of like, oh, is this the Vinegar Syndrome? Is this going to be like, ooh, we're going to get the film remastered, no extra bits in it, but we're going to get the film, the big the massive feature-length documentary, and all the deleted scenes, because there's a lot of deleted scenes in this movie. I know I've discussed it a little before, and you can see a lot of these deleted scenes on YouTube. They are there if you want to care to find them, but it won't really add a great deal to your viewing experience, because there's so much more which has been cut out, which is just gone. But so if these guys can put together a release that has a beautiful 4K image of The Key with a gorgeously remastered 5.1 Atmos whatever rendition of Tangerine Dream's score, and commentary tracks, and you know, I mean, would Michael Mann ever return to it to say, you know, well, this is what I intended, but this is not what I got? Wouldn't it be great? Michael Mann's not going to do that, though. He won't do it. There's a very curious scene in the version that we got of The Key, which is akin to a very curious scene in one of my favourite movies of all time, from Michael Mann, The Last of the Mohicans, with Daniel Day-Lewis. Right at the very end, they've gone to promontory in Mohicans, and Mag was being killed, and all that, blah, blah, blah. And it's a big standoff. And Daniel Day-Lewis, Hawkeye, with his musket, retreats from the last surviving Huron warriors. And we cut to a frame of a rock, just a rock slab with a horizontal line through it, which is just, you're like, and it hangs there for too long, and you're going like, okay, is there some kind of symbolism here? What's that about? Well, having just watched The Keep again recently, there is a sequence in The Keep where you'd have a slab of rock with a horizontal line in it, and this was like, what, 10 years before he did Mohicans. I don't know, is there a connection? I don't know, is it symbolism? I don't know. I'd like to hear what he says about it, but regardless, The Keep is a film which definitely gets into you. It seeps into your bones. The book is brilliant. The book is rereadable, and I don't say that about books very often. Films are rewatchable a lot. I watch bits of movies Escape from New York and, you know, Rambo movies. I watch bits of them. I don't necessarily watch the entire movie, but I watch bits all the time, very regularly. Books, I might return to certain things, certain passages, certain chapters, but not as often. But The Keep, I return to certain elements. And the thing about The Keep is that the opening, and the opening sort of, I don't know, 20, 25 minutes of The Keep, Michael Mann's version, the version that we've got, is excellent. It's truly excellent. It totally embodies what F. Paul Wilson described, and the atmospherics, the visuals, that when you're reading it, certainly for myself, that's what I visualized. It's done slightly differently, but once you got a sort of a prologue, and then you get like the Captain Vermin, Jürgen Prochnow, arrives with his squad just to, you know, look over the watchtower of the keep. That introduction in the movie with Tangerine Dream's score, which I can't play because it's on the fucking computer, and I love that bit of music. It's just fucking amazing. The Dinu Pass, Stormbringer, as some people might know it as, but that is exactly when I read the book and I saw the movie only young, and I went, that they've nailed it. That is exactly how I pictured, you know, Vermin and his squad of German shoulders, a lot of Teutonic shoulders shuffling about, you know, arriving in this Carpathian Pass, the Dinu Pass, with these vertical. You know, they filmed it in Wales, literally, which is where I'm sitting right now. They filmed it, I would say 40 miles as a crow flies, that way, from where I'm sitting right now, that way. To get there from here, it's not 40 miles. You've got to go around the Wirral Peninsula and go all the way around down to Chester and go back all the way, and then you've got to cross, and but as a crow flies, it's about 40 miles away. In slate mines and all that, and it does look incredible. It looks brilliant. It does look somewhere other than Wales or the British Isles. It looks Carpathian, gothic, and cold and dismal. So I don't know, because I want to see a great version of Michael Mann's theatrical cut of The Keep. I want to see that. I want to see an extended cut. You ain't going to get that because all the footage is gone. And the footage that remains, which you can see in deleted scenes, is wretched. It died a death with the test audiences. So they had to cobble together stuff, and it just didn't work. He knew it wasn't going to work, which is why he was like, I don't want not to do that movie ever again. It's a thorn in my ass. I'm not going to get involved in it. I can understand that. You sweat blood and tears into a project that you love, that you're massively into. I've done this. I wrote three books. Two got published. I won a literary award. Yay! Kilt-Man won a literary award. The can't even say it. Cause it's poison to me now. Only won one award. The Shell Research Prize for Literature. And I got two books published on the back of that, like. And the third book, which was in a publishing deal for, I walked out on. I never got published. Hey, what an idiot. But that's what, you know, artists and creators do. No, it's my integrity. This is not the vision I had. This is not the idea I had. And you're manipulating it and you're changing things and you're messing me about. Well, I will just walk away. And I did that. And Michael Mann did that. So many filmmakers do the same sort of thing, and I admire that, you know, because, you know, look, that's not the film I was trying to make. You guys got in there, manipulated it, changed it. That's not what I wanted. So fuck you, I'm out of here. I don't know, you know, I agree with him. But I'm also like, oh, because I'm a fan and I want to see these things. And I'm like, oh my God, I'd love to see what you did, but you're never going to see it. You've got to, us keep fans, I've got to like keep in mind that we're never going to see that version. The effects weren't done. You watched those deleted scenes. Yeah, it doesn't give you a great deal, does it? And like, oh, I want to see them reinstated. No, you don't. No, you don't. It ain't gonna happen. It will not happen. But we all want, well, a lot of us want, that dreamboat of the key three to three and a half hour cut movie. Not gonna get it. So let's just get the theatrical cut remastered with glorious Dolby Atmos sound, just great surround sound, because it does sound great. It is a wonderful, wonderful score, a great sound design. So, you know, it does work. And just have everything cleaned up. We can appreciate its troubled, you know, back history and its truncated, continuity destroyed narrative. Bristol, it can still work as a fever dream. A gothic wartime fever dream. It's one of those. I've discussed all its subtext and inner narratives before in those two previous videos. So, you know, I won't go into all that right now. But I would love to see this. Look, Vinegar Syndrome. VS, you guys, do it. Your artist, what's his name again? Edward Kinsella. Your stuff was great. You did a take on that, which is fine, and the original VHS and Betamax slipcover artwork, you did that. But then you did something else, which was pure Mike Mignola from Hellboy. And as far as I can say, it worked. I've got those images, and they're great. come on. Why are they suppressing it again? This is the thing. This guy put his artwork out there and suddenly within what 30 minutes it got taken down. Shit. I've let the cat out of the bag. And like Vinegar Syndrome, no, damn you, you fool, you can't do this. Come back in here, and they reined him back in. I don't know. I do not know. But they put it out there and on their own site, because I've seen their site, and it says, this is our VHS slip cover. This is our Blu-ray UHD cover. So that would make you think they have the key about to be unleashed on Blu-ray and UHD. And VHS. Should you want that, you know, some people do. I don't know, folks, I don't know. I really want this. I really want to be playing the Keep soundtrack. That is not this. I have the full thing, but I can't play it. And I'm wearing the Splinter, the early World War II German Splinter camouflage, which they do wear in. Thank you. It's all right. Yeah, I'm here every night, you know. I'm a resident. Kilt Mansion, barbecue, and disco. They do wear this in the movie. They wear capes cowls and stuff like so. Folks, The Keep. My daughter wrote me some quotes from it. There is a great early sequence where Vermin, Jürgen Prochnow, meets Alexandru, who is the retainer of the keep. Hang on a minute. Are we playing anything here? Oh, get lost. Vermin has just arrived there. And these are the friendly Germans ish, you know. And I like, they see all the crucifixes on the walls. I was like, what are these? Now they're just nickel. There's 108 of them. In the book, there's several thousand of them. When in the film, it's 108. I think it's 108, something like that. And but he goes like, because the Germans are going to move in there. So Alexandru, who's the retainer with his sons and his father before him did it, and his father before that, and his father before that, and my sons will carry on. But anyway, so he says to Vermin, you cannot stay here. And why not? No one stays here. And who forbids it? No one forbids. Some travellers have stayed. We don't stop them. But no one stays the night. And Vermin's like, ghosts? Demons? No. No ghosts here. Deaths then? Suicides? No one's ever died here. Then what drives people out in the middle of the rainy night? Dreams. Which is, it's a great haunting moment. Vermin does counter this. He says like, because he's just gone like, Alexandru, the retainer of the keep, has just gone like, dreams. Keep them out of there, like nightmares. Look, man, the real nightmares man has made upon other men in this war. The bad dreams of your keep are but nursery rhymes by comparison. From that alone, you know that what the film should have shown would be absolutely unparalleled. The Germans, the Wehrmacht, the Nazis, the Waffen-SS, the Einsatzkommandos should have been faced with what they do, the genocide they're committing, is going to be wrought upon them tenfold, and they're going to be really fucking terrified, tortured, and absolutely obliterated in the most apocalyptic fashion. And that is, because that's the line. That is the thing. Again, Alexandru says, well, Vermin says, like, then what drives people out in the middle of the rainy night? Dreams. Nightmares. Look, man, the real nightmares man has made upon other men in this war. The bad dreams of your keep are but nursery rhymes by comparison. And yeah, they're not. And in the film itself, there's so much between Vermin and Kampfer, Gabriel Byrne. He was brilliant, with the most horrible haircut the world has ever, ever known. And I've seen Death Wish 3 and Exterminator 2 for that matter, but with the world's worst haircuts. But there's great conversations had between Jürgen Prochnow and Gabriel Byrne. But you know there's much more that should have been said, and there's huge chunks that have gone missing. Robert Prosky, again, the priest in the village, there's tons between him and Ian McKellen, which has clearly gone right fucking ransacked. Oh, it's gone. This dickhead they brought in to re-edit the movie made a right ham-fisted job of it. And why does the film still work? because it's haunting. It has a magical quality, a necromantic quality, call it, which lives beyond what you see on screen, what you hear. You know there's tons missing, but it still has a resonance of power, which is great. There's a god-awful sex scene. There really is a god-awful sex scene. And the lightsabers, which come in at the end, which are really, really bad. The talisman and how they connect to keep... doesn't matter. Does not matter. Well, it kind of does matter, but... But bloody hell, some effects there are really cheeseball and awful. But you know why? The effects guy died, and they had to cobble together stuff. And a lot of things they just couldn't finish off, couldn't get right. Oh, just put the fucking film out there. And by the way, you know, I made this film, but I want nothing to do with it. I'm turning my back on it. So, if Vinegar Syndrome do get this release out, wouldn't you love Michael Mann to be approached and like, can you do a commentary? It'd be one of the best commentaries ever. I hate this fucking movie. I hate everybody involved in it. They're all twats. They destroyed me. They lied about me. Ah, they fire. Wouldn't that be worth listening to? It would though. But I'm sure he would see a bit of value and the stuff that he did put in there and how he did. The elements that come together do come together. I watched it, you know, God, very recently, and even the conclusion, the final face-off between Glake and Trisha Darthus, Scott Glenn and Rassilon Mossilar, which was always a lackluster, just like a really shitty pop video light show. With smoking effects, you know, and dry ice and all that. This film's got a lot of dry ice in it, a lot of dry ice. But it worked. I actually got more invested in the climax of it the last time I watched it than ever before. Before, and I would have been like, oh, really? Is that it? Right, yeah. You've got this lightsaber hilt, yeah, you know, these wings on it, this mechanic, and lights, hit the button, light show. Well, last time I watched it, it worked. It genuinely, I was more moved by the conclusion than ever before. I don't know. But I've been drinking, you know. And I forgot the girl's name in it. And I should have mentioned it. I have forgot the girl's name. Didn't write it down. Or did I? No, I did not. I always thought she was... she looks a bit like Isabella Gianni, which it's not Isabella Gianni from Possession and many of the movies, of course. But she's good. But she has a because the editing, there's a cataclysmically bad element. She meets Scott Glenn, and straight away they're in love on a really sort of Highlander level, you know, and it's just bizarre. And they have a really horrible, horrible sex scene, which is just so naff. And she is so imploring to, he's on a mission, he's come back. He's immortal, but he's got to come back to finish off, you know, this beast from the keep. And like, she's like, yeah. Why did you come to me? Become my lover. And you're like, I only met you like an hour before. The way this film is constructed. I only met you just before and I just shagged you. We sat on the mountaintop and we had a heart to heart. And like, you know, I don't love you. But in the book, it's very important. But that's all truncated. But it's made elaborately, like, and she's like, oh, screaming when he gets shot to bits and then is resurrected. And oh, it, in the film, it doesn't make any sense. In the book, it makes perfect sense. So the keep, we have got a possible remake, and we have a possible release of the original version. I mean, Greg Nicotero, I don't know what's happened to that. I have no idea what's happened to that. Writer's strike, it's way gone. Nicotero is a good director, and he cut his teeth with special effects, makeup effects, with KMB, Howard Berger, Greg Nicotero, and Robert Kurtzman. That's the KNB. Yeah, done it. I did it right there. Robert Kirkman created The Walking Dead, which Greg Nicotero did the effects for and then directed and became the head honcho of. So, massive connection there. But a good director, and he wants to get this done. But the last I heard of this was, the start of last year. So what's happened? Oh, hang on. Writer's strike. Fucking whatever. I don't know. Where's it going? Are we going to get a new version of The Keep? Are we not? Are we going to get any version of the original The Keep, which we can keep and cherish? Anyway, folks, this Tangerine Dream is not from The Keep. I have that holy grail of The Keep score. I have it, but I can't play it. Ta-da! What a pain in the ass. And it's wonderful. The opening sequences, I may have said at the start of this, I don't remember, because I've been here for a while now. So have you, if you're still here. Good luck to you. Jürgen Prochnow and his platoon are arriving at Dinu Pass in the pissing down rain, and all their armoured cars and tanks, and they're bringing cannon, artillery, dragging them through. That is exactly, and I mean exactly, how I visualised, not the opening of the book. The opening of the book is his, it's sort of like, it's told in advance. It's his advance warning to, look, I need reinforcements. I'm in shit here at this keep. And then it sort of goes back, chapter one goes back to his arrival. And that's exactly, Michael Mann filmed it absolutely, almost surgically precise, how I imagined how that would look. So when I saw the film the first time, I was like, canal. Oh, wow, we're definitely there. This is it. And then the dreamy entrance into the Dinu Pass and the village there, and there's the keep. Although, to be honest, I've been in Wales many, many times, in the slate mines and quarries many, many times. And I meant, oh, that's just Wales. That's the embarrassed. And it is. But in a way, that's great, because it's just down the road. I could go and visit the setting for this movie. Anyway, folks, I have been almost Shelby Kilt-Man. So please, in the meantime, when this ever, could we ever get a really good version of The Keep? In between time, please keep it kilted, keep it, and I'm gonna see you all later. Gabriel Byrne takes the crucifix off them, who he just shot several times through the back. Shot him through the back because they're Nazi fucking cowards. Just kill kids. And that's a big confrontation between Vermin and Camphor. You know, what courage have you ever shown? You killed children, Camphor, you know. What courage is that, you know? He shoots in the back anyway. But Theodore Kuza, Gandalf, has given him the cross. He's like, but you're a Jew, why do you have a cross? It was given to me by a friend as protection. I'll give it to you now because you're a man of compassion. So he takes it, but before he can use it, like, gets shot in the back, and at the end, like, Gabriel Byrne has gone out, and all his men, all the Wehrmacht and all the Einsatz commandos are fucking wasted. They're all blown into walls, their eyeballs are fucking singed, and they're like, and in the mist enshrouded fucking courtyard of the keep, he's like, with the cross like that, and Molossar Rassilon comes up behind him with hulking blue muscles, and he's like, what are you? Yeah. Where's the quote? I've got a quote here somewhere. No, I haven't. Yeah. He's like, what do you fear? I fear you. What do you think I am? I am you. I've misquoted that. If you're still here, you're going like, oh, you fucking dickhead. And I am. I've completely forgotten the quote. But he grabs the crucifix and just goes, and then grabs Gabriel Byrne by the throat and goes, and all his fucking life force comes out and he just fucking hails his body. Brilliant. Weirdly enough, Gabriel Byrne would then go on to play Satan in Peter Hyams' almost great End of Days with Arnie Schwarzenegger. I'm a massive fan of Peter Hyams as a director, a massive fan of Arnie Schwarzenegger, of course, but End of Days has its moments. It does. So it's got a great John Debney score. It's got some great Miriam Margulies kicks the ghoulies off Arnie Schwarzenegger in it. But the film is still, it's bloody stupid. You know, it's so horribly rife with biblical rhetoric and reference. Your hero's called Jericho Cain. But it has got some great elements to it. Arnie gets beaten to a pulp and crucified by a bunch of rabid fucking Satanists. It's got great elements to it. But Gabriel Byrne is the devil. He possessed... Gabriel Byrne plays like a Wall Street banker who gets possessed by Satan and then goes off on the rampage to rape on the turn of millennium to bring about the downfall of fucking whatever the prophecy is. Who cares? These prophecies never fucking happen. All you ever hear is prophecies, this, that, and the other. Oh, the stars are in alignments. This has happened. Oh my God, four goats lay down in the street today. That is it. It's over. It's just shite. My tea bag burst in my cup today. That's it. I am destined to shit all over the toilet seat. It doesn't fucking matter. You can read into whatever you... And tea leaves. People do read into tea leaves. If you... But it makes stories, it makes plots. And the End of Days is good fun, but... And I love Peter Hyams as a director. Outland, I discussed recently. And there's many... Busting. Oh, my Christ. Capricorn 1. Ah, the guy is a... The Relic. Fantastic director of action. Presidio. But... End of Days, he gets to work with Arnie. I know he worked with Jean-Claude Van Damme for about three or four movies, but he gets Arnie. Arnie's meant to be a down and out, you know. He's thinking like, oh, I've lost my wife and all that, and he's got a bit of stubble on him, but he's still like the granite jaw. He's still clearly fucking huge and well defined, and he's just eating pizza, cold pizza. And cold coffee in the morning. Fuck off. You're working out at least 6 to 8 hours a day. mate. I love it though. I love shit like that. It's movies, mate. It's movies. Mm. We did finish about 10 minutes ago, but hey ho, you know, it is what it is. So the keep. Don't bother your ass writing below. Oh, the keep shit. I fucking hate it. Well, you know, that's your opinion. I won't reply to that if you say that, because I don't think it is. It's a troubled movie. You know it's a troubled movie. And what you got was actually pretty impressive, to be perfectly honest. And frustrating as it is, it's still great entertainment and a dreamy, surreal, hypnotic experience which does seep into you. You don't quickly forget it. You don't. It's a very difficult film to love, but it's even harder to hate because there's something about it which works. Given the fact it had such a troubled backstory, we all love Apocalypse Now. Oh my God, what a catastrophic, you know, production history that film had. Okay, it turned out massively impressive, but then again, you've got different versions of it, of course. And wouldn't you like the different versions of The Keep? Because you could have the real masterpiece could be there. Just didn't transpire that way. But yeah, every godforsaken demon, beast, vampire, folkloric, golem-esque, legendary monster lurking within the confines of a keep can have its day. Hopefully so. I'm going to see you all laters. Second time round. Laters. Teutonic. Titanically, teutonically terrifying. Jawohl. Mein Führer.